Everybody, I'm John Riley. I'm here with Steve Strimer, one of the partners in Collective Copies, and we're going to take a tour of the operation of their printing and publishing operation today. Steve, where are we right now? What room is this? What goes on in here?
This is the Leveler's Press production area.
Okay.
And we're also trying to tailor it as a place, and we've already had several book launches and book readings here. So we're trying to get it better so that we can tear it down from a production setup to a reading setup with short notice.
That's
like a quick change of sets.
That's pretty unique. You know, you've mentioned in the past that the printer was a publisher once upon a time, and you're doing that now. You're a printer, publisher. What are the roots of that kind of concept?
Well, for me, the roots are, you know, my very beginning in the printing was as an astrologer. I don't know if people remember the New Age back in the late 70s in the Valley. Mm-hmm. Well, we had something called the Astrologers Guild, and we wanted to publish a monthly magazine. And I was printing at the Gazette. I was my first printing job after college was at the Hampshire Gazette.
Mm-hmm. What was the publication called?
Well, we never got that far, finally. It never finally came out. We broke up. We were going to start one called Asterisk,
okay,
right? Aster being star and risk being what we were doing.
Okay.
Asterisk, right? And with a little asterisk as our logo. It would have been nice, don't you think?
But
an asterisk is a star.
That got you started with printing.
That got me started with printing because I went and estimated what it would cost to get to print this job, print this book, you know, a magazine, and we had some books in mind too, and it was just, we had no money, and so instead I just saved my money to buy a printing press until I finally had enough to buy a multi-lith. I don't know if people remember old multi-lith.
No.
They were small, sort of almost glorified duplicator, basically, as a printing press.
Not like a mimeograph.
No, a real printing press,
okay.
A real offset
okay.
printing press, but right. not, you know, not your best.
How much did it cost you?
Well, here's the thing. I saved $1,900.
Wow.
I knew I had one, okay. But I decided I'd go down to my father's friend, Tom Latriciano, down in Putnam County, New York, drove down there and to have him advise me on how I could get the best press, pre-press stuff, because I didn't know much. I knew how to do web press things a little bit. But he said, I have this other press over here. And so he sold me a 17.5 by 22.5 inch book press for next to nothing, a Royal Zenith Jobber 22.
Okay.
And I think because he loved my father so much, he gave me this amazing deal on it. So
you could print books, you could do pretty much anything at that point.
Right. So, yes, and you could print books in 16-page signatures.
Okay.
Right. That was big enough to print a 5.5, 8.5 book, one of your standard sizes, in 16-page signatures. So by him giving me that press, we had to drive down there and grab it. This was Aldebaran Press, okay. That was going to be, because we were still interested in astrology
star,
at the
yes.
time. Aldebaran is the right eye of the bull in Taurus. It's a lovely star, by the way, Aldebaran Press. So that's how we started. And because I got that press, everything that surrounded to make the plates for that press, we had to figure out how we were going to build it up. And so
where was this going at that point? Were you in Florence or where were you?
Well, we initially moved the press to a barn, Mike Florio's barn on School Street.
Okay.
And then we had Paul Britt, a local builder, build us a barn out behind our house in Haydenville. Mm-hmm. The press was kind of a very small operation, and the members of the press bought a house up in Haydenville, lived together, and built a barn out behind the house.
What were you printing at that point? I mean, you couldn't have just been doing astrology. I mean, you had to have something else going on.
Well, when we walk around, I'll show you.
Okay.
Hanging on the wall there is my very first color poster I ever printed.
Okay. Okay, cool. Well, we'll get a picture
and
of that.
Steve Pettigorsky, that's a Steve Pettigorsky photograph.
Nice. He's very well known.
Doug Herring, my first partner, worked on the separations for it. I think they went to Hampshire together.
So you really got into printing.
Immediately. Yeah. And remember, this was Three Mile Island. I mean, this was anti-nukes. We were always had a political perspective, really. And so very early on, this was anti-nuke kind of stuff. So we did a lot of that kind of printing for the movement. But then we would get bid on books. We'd learn, you know, because this was a place. Doug knew people at Hampshire Typothetai, which came out of Gehenna Press.
Very major.
So that Doug mostly had contacts within that kind of world of classy letterpress printing. So we kind of early on established that we wanted to do, you know, do high quality work. And I've kind of been a perfectionist.
What year,
the end. So
what
we
year
got
are we
more,
talking about? You said 77.
77 is when I got the press.
Okay.
And 79 was Three Mile Island, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
Is that right? And
you were called Aldebaran Press?
Aldebaran Press.
Okay.
And then a very good friend of mine, one of my oldest friends in the Valley, Bob Gardner. He won't mind me calling him a lefty pinko. Proto-communist guy, you know.
Back when everybody was.
But Bob walked the walk. He really did. Still does. He's on VFR now. Occupy the Airwaves at 10 o'clock Sunday mornings. Bob's on that show.
That's a nice plug.
Yeah. And Bob, we were kind of this close, you know. Nancy Luneau's dad had put up a lot of money for making the press happen. She was somewhat, had some means, and he was kind enough to help us with the house and all that. But basically, Bob saw that we wanted to become a worker co-op, because worker co-ops were beginning to happen at that time. I don't know if people remember the Citizens Involvement Training Project at UMass. Dave Magnani and many other folks over there were working on a new economic models, and the other, excuse me.
Was that out of the economics department, or where was that?
I think it was out of the economics department.
Yeah, you must have Magnani
went on to be
economics department.
Yeah. Magnani went on to become a state rep and very active in the in worker ownership at the state level. So at any rate, that was another of our core markets, if you wanted to. If we ever thought in those terms, we really didn't. But was the food co-op movement, and people, River Valley Market, you know, is the logical, you know, that big co-op. It's one of the largest co-ops around. But we had, you know, New Roots was one of our was the newsletter of the Western Mass co-op food co-op network.
That's really interesting. You worked with the
so
other
that was one of our big jobs. Yeah. So that was the cooperative movement, and the and then we went right into the Iran-Contra war.
Yeah.
You know, and
so this was late 70s. I've always thought that the 60s didn't happen until the 70s. So we're busy doing other stuff, but like you
it
were
took
really
root in, it took root in the 70s.
Yeah, it
you
took
know,
root
especially
in the
70s. Around
yeah.
here.
Yeah.
You know, and so we really aligned ourselves with that. But back to Bob's story. Bob became our first employee at Aldebaran Press, but immediately, due to internal squabbles, two of our original partners left, and Bob and Martha Yoder and I became Commonwealth Printing and incorporated in the new 157A statute in Massachusetts. Massachusetts was one of the earliest states to provide a worker-owned cooperative corporation as an actual legal
what
status.
What were the benefits of that?
The benefits of that were we never took advantage of some of the major benefits of that, which is being able to raise funds through Class B non-voting stock without registering with the SEC. People, you could get community support, in other words, for worker co-ops without those people having to know how to read balance state and balance sheets and income statements, all the restrictions of the SEC, you could get support that way. And it had the ICA, the Industrial Cooperative Association in Somerville, were people who really led the charge to get that statute. And they wrote their model bylaws. And in fact, our bylaws at Collective Copies are based on those original, I think, 1977, neighborhood ICA bylaws.
I remember Commonwealth Printing fairly well. I mean, that was a big operation. I mean, you were doing
we had 14 workers. I was thinking back about, you know, when we peaked out for our little single color press operation, mm-hmm.
How many presses did you have by then? I mean, you had 14 employees. Were you still operating on
Hayden Hill? We had four presses, I guess.
In Hayden Hill?
We moved to Hadley.
That's right.
We moved to we moved down to Fred Englander's building at the East Street Dance Studios now. People may know that, 47 East Street.
Big water tower. Yes.
Big water tower, where one of the great letterpress designers lives there, Art Larson. I mean, he works there at Horton Tank Graphics.
Also, and Troubadour Books and Good Matter Books.
We were.
Oh, you were in that exact spot?
We were in that exact spot. That's kind of nice. Yeah. Huh? Think about
big
that.
Big cement floors. You can put heavy presses in there.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. But, one of one of the great moments in our history down there was... it was actually the most interesting weekend of my life, I think.
Okay.
The Patriots were in the Super Bowl.
Okay.
Right?
Was that against Chicago?
1986 against Chicago, yeah. Right? A group of people from our Central America network were down in Nicaragua building a school, and their town was attacked by the Contras, and four people in their town were killed by Contras in the town where our project was.
Yeah,
As we formed the project, it was supposedly in a rather safe region.
Yeah.
By the time the project happened, it had become part of a war zone, and we decided to go anyway. So nobody of our group was killed, but four there. People they even knew in the village were right. So
how dangerous.
We're hearing this while I'm watching the Super Bowl. Okay, and then the next morning was the Challenger disaster.
Oh my God!
And right, we had a flood here. We had the most crazy flood where it was totally frozen. All of Hadley was frozen.
Yeah,
and
river
it
really
rained
came
like
up.
Crazy.
Yeah.
Well, it wasn't so much a river flood. It was that the ground was totally frozen. It rained like crazy. And we came in Monday morning, and our whole press op room was under 18 inches of water. So I spent the day, Monday, pulling the compressors out of the presses, taking them down to McKinney Electric, and having them dry out the motors and compressors for us.
This
to
was
try
all
and
one
salvage
weekend.
Them. This all happened, right? And that day, that's where...
Something was in the stars.
You remember where, when Kennedy was shot, you remember where you were, right? So that's what I was doing. I was down there when it came across. I was watching the Challenger launch, and there it goes. It was just like such... It was
one
a full moon, too.
Okay.
It was astrologer's
dream. That's what I was
going to
say.
It was a full moon,
that's
too.
What I was just going to say.
All right. So, anyway, that's a digression. But
that's really... No, that's interesting because, people can go and visit that bookshop now and get a feel for how big your operation was and where it was.
And if you're there, you are next to one of the great printers in America there, Dan Kelleher at Wild Carrot Letterpress.
And hopefully we can film Dan in this series.
That would be great. That is something else. This is a meticulous. If I have a mentor, I have a couple mentors, Dan, which makes sense because he's one of the great printers of all time. He knew Harold McGrath, and he worked up at Jimmy Cooney's. Jimmy Cooney, Morningstar Press up in Waitley, was the long time. People should look this up. The long time editor of the Phoenix. Arthur Miller and other people had some of their original pieces published. Very prominent.
I've seen some of those come through my bookshop over the years, yeah.
And then the other part that ties right into when Marshall Bloom and the Liberation News Service moved their presses and those great stories, you should look at Ray Mungo's story of the Liberation News Service and how they moved to Montague. The story of that, Famous Long Ago. Have you ever?
I've seen that book.
Oh, you got to read Famous Long Ago.
I didn't know that it had Montague.
Famous Long Ago. You got to look at that. It tells about the night that the there was a split at the Liberation News Service between really the hippies and the SDS factions, right? And Steve Diamond was a friend of the Beatles, knew the Beatles, and so they were they had the Beatles agreed to have the American launch of Magical Mystery Tour benefit the Liberation News Service. And this Liberation News Service was a big deal. These folks built it up for we at my school. We were you know, we had stuff coming out from them for our newsletters, anti-war in the 60s, and so they were a big deal. 400 outlets across the country. Their big thing was they were the only journalists let in at the Columbia takeover at Columbia University. So that's how they. But anyway. So Steve Diamond, they were all out. Everybody went to the opening of Magical Mystery Tour.
Where was it?
The hippie wing of the Liberation News Service stole the presses, loaded up the presses.
Oh, while they were gone.
While everybody was at the thing, they loaded up the presses and put super glue in the locks of the building and came up here to Massachusetts with the presses. Right?
Oh my God, this is like
and
the
60s. And as it turns out, they
come to life.
They hit, we found out when we did one of our original books, maybe I can show it to you, Daniel Shea's Legacy, Marshall Bloom.
Why don't you grab that? We're going to take a quick break. I just want to make sure that we've got everything going right.
Okay.
This is great, Steve. I mean, this is real, some incredible history. I can't believe. Okay. So you were just telling me about the Daniel Shea's book. Which one is this?
We were talking about Marshall Bloom, right? This is a picture of Marshall. The Marshall Bloom Archive is at Amherst College. People can go visit it and learn about the first New Age of the 60s.
Were you involved in this publishing group, the Liberation News?
No. I was a freshman at Amherst College.
Okay.
When Marshall Bloom committed suicide. That was one of the sad things that happened in the movement. He was...
How old was he?
He probably... Oh, so he would have been 21 in 66. He graduated in 66. He led the rather famous walkout and black armbands for McNamara, who spoke at Amherst College commencement in 66.
Good for
him. They led the walkout, and then he went over. He was the editor of the Amherst Student, but in any event, his buddy and co-adjutor at the Montague farm was Ray Mungo, and others, Steve Diamond, and Tom Fells, who works over at UMass now, has written a great book about this, almost an essential book about this. There's a new book out called Farm Friends, which people can get. But anyway, this is our book on it. Amy Stevens wrote, I think it was a master's thesis. This is one of our early books, a master's thesis on the farm with new research. And one of the things we found out, because I know... Jimmy Cooney's son, Gabriel Cooney, I talked with him and found out that when they came to the valley with those presses, when they absconded with the Liberation News Service presses, again, maybe a little multi-lith, I'm not sure, they stored them in Jimmy Cooney's barn in Hatfield, where he had a barn on Sunset Avenue in Hatfield. And they stored it there until they moved it up to the Montague farm. So little details
now,
like
that. Now, when you talk about Jimmy Cooney, I know Eliza Cooney.
That's his daughter.
Okay. She'll be happy to hear this.
Oh, yeah.
She knows all about it.
Yeah. I mean...
We'll have to get her involved in...
Her father and her mother are heroes, and real heroes of this whole period. The period before this. They were the sort of grandparents of the hippie generation. So... So at any rate, where are we? That was all going on, and as it turned out, so remember I had to fill in around that press that my father's
And it survived friend, the flood. Okay.
It survived the flood, but no, back backing
oh, we're
up,
farther back.
Back okay. going back to 77 and 78 when okay. we were building the first press. That's where I went. I went up to Morning Star Farm at Jimmy Cooney's because Dan Kelleher, who was Jimmy Cooney's press operator at the time, and where Nancy Haver, who's one of my co-workers here at Collective Copies, one of the longest, our second most senior member here, also worked up at Morning Star Farm with Dan, doing stuff with Jimmy around collating, typesetting, different things she did. She's
remind
a great
me,
artist.
Remind me of Jimmy's press, the name.
Morning Star
okay.
Farm.
Okay.
I think it was Morning Star Press, mm-hmm. Up in Waitley. It was a pig farm originally that he cleared out. It was like a total mess when he went in there, and it's one of the most beautiful places on earth, yeah. up at the top of a hill. But anyway, that's where Dan had a 1918 Cleveland folder, hand-fed folder, 25-38 inches, huge folder, because they had big presses up there. Mm-hmm. They had a 38-inch, I think, press up there. So that's the folding machine. That's where I did all my folding originally. Was I'd drive up there, do those 16-page signatures, and that's how I got to know Dan.
When did Leveler's Press get started?
Leveler's?
Yeah.
Officially?
Yeah,
in September of 2009 with the launch of Slavery in the Connecticut Valley by
This is 2005.
Robert. This is 2005. So Collective Copies had brought out, I think, six titles before, as Collective Copies,
okay.
Before Leveler's began, and we decided to give it a name.
Okay. How long has Collective Copies been around?
Since 1983.
Where did that come from in this evolution of all these printing operations you've been involved in?
It started as a really Collective Copies goes back to a strike against Noman Copies, which was a big regional chain for copy shops. And boy, back in those days, there were a lot of copies made. I mean, people don't, a lot of Xerox copies made.
Because people didn't have their own copiers.
Part of the bread and butter of Collective Copies throughout its early, or through most of its history to this point, there's been a change, is academic course readers. And we became very expert at clearing copyrights. We cleared more copyrights than any copy shop in the state for a while because of UMass. We would have maybe 130, 140 course packets in the fall semester and almost that many in the spring semester.
That's why we have these huge copyrights.
We invested $250,000 in a copy machine to run them, our Xerox Docutex back in the day. So it was a very Noman did that kind of thing early on. It wasn't quite as big as it got to be with us, but in the and this there was a shop that was down where Panda Garden is.
Okay.
And it would have been back then right across from the old Yellow Sun Co-op. Remember, that was quite a... So that was a hotbed of that kind of... So at any rate, and the working conditions were horrible. They had next to no ventilation. Mm-hmm. There was, toner dust and paper dust in the air, all the time. And, so bad conditions, pretty bad wages. So they struck against Noman for better conditions and wages. And got locked out and picketed for 6 months with the support of the community.
Wow.
And then they relented and then closed down the shop.
Wow.
and Collective Copies bought it out.
Amazing.
Mostly through supporters of the workers, because there was a lot of support that was garnered through 6 months of strikes in this political community. Mostly through friends of that group of workers buying advance copies. In other words, prepaying for copying. In other words, they did it without really much loan. Mm-hmm. They did it by customers who became loyal customers of Collective Copies, paying for their copies in advance. In other words, floating them enough to buy the equipment, get a new space, rent a new space. So we've been at three or four different locations since then.
This is really interesting. From all the stories that you've told so far, is the driving force behind so much of your interest in printing and the printing in the Valley was political. It was got you interested in the first place and continued the interest of printing and publishing and getting this information out. It's interesting how that was the driving force. I don't think everybody knows about that, you know.
Yeah, and really, the Gazette, this is my understanding, the Gazette, the Hampshire Gazette, started back in, September 7th. Very interesting that the Valley Advocate and the Gazette both started on September 7th, from an astrological point of view. But it might be just that it's September.
Now, you said the Gazette was the earliest printing in the Valley?
Yeah, it's 1786. It's one of the longest running newspapers, but it started as a reaction to Shays' Rebellion.
Okay.
You know, what would be considered maybe right wing. It was a reaction to Shays' Rebellion.
Interesting. Now, Levelish Press, you have several other imprints. Why do you have different imprints? You have Hedgerow, I believe it is.
Yeah. And yeah. Oh, well, here you go. You know, to come to publishing from the background of being a printer, which that's unusual in itself in the modern era, right? I mean, originally, I think that was part of what the story was. You were a publisher, you were a printer, you were an editor, you know, all that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And even though, you know, I didn't do very well. I mean, I went, my education is not as great as it could be. I'm not, and in the end, I'm a reader, but I read mostly nonfiction. Right, history is what I'm mostly interested in. So I didn't consider myself, because this place is, more poets, they could, you know, come out of the woodwork in this mm-hmm. valley, right?
Well,
and we wanted to yeah. be able to publish poetry, and so the only way I could think that it could work, and not, once we hung our shingle out as a poetry publisher,
mm-hmm.
and not be just inundated with manuscripts, was to have a real screening process and have people who know poetry.
Mm, as right? your editors. Or...
Know poetry. And so we began working with Diana Gordon, mm-hmm. One of our first Hedgerow poets, became and is still our managing editor at Hedgerow Books.
Just to go back a little bit to track what you had said about you know, you weren't as educated as you wish you were, but talking to Bill Streeter, I had the same exact statement from him, is that he was a tinkerer, and he wanted things his own way. He built things just exactly the way he wanted, and we kind of decided between the two of us that that was a defining characteristic of the Valley, that you had people here that just wanted to do things their own way, and weren't going to take any other path unless it was going to be their way.
And who finally weren't mm-hmm. motivated by financial gain
exactly.
as much as wanting to live their lives the way they wanted to.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, that was really, and that was the inspiration of the Montague Farm and that back to the land movement back then.
Mm-hmm.
These people were really dirt poor. What they did in famous long ago, what they did just to make ends meet,
mm-hmm.
Was crazy. And it was a big, you know, unregistered car. They didn't have enough. It was crazy,
yeah.
And they weren't great farmers. You know, they were adequate farmers, but I think you look back and our current wave of farming in this valley, you know, goes back to that, back to the land movement in the '60s from Montague Farm and Total Loss Farm and the other ones around self-sufficiency.
Yeah. Self-sufficient. Another thing that I was noticing in what you were talking about in terms of how you got into printing and Levelish Press and all the rest is the self-publishing movement is really, you've fostered that with your press, with what you're doing. And I think that plays into, I want to do it my way. People couldn't get published. You would write a book, it could be a really great book, but no publisher would touch it.
Right.
I mean, think of all the great writers that couldn't get published.
Or if they touched it, you wouldn't recognize it by the end.
Yeah, yeah. The number of rejection letters, you know, that J.D. Salinger got was immense, or Jack Kerouac. I mean, they couldn't find publishers. When they did, then they became famous. But
mm-hmm.
so many people are writing and have things to say, and I think that the whole self-publishing movement has really allowed so many more voices to come out. And I think that's, isn't that pretty much what you're involved in? Would you call it self-publishing?
I mean, I don't consider Levelers Press self-publishing.
Okay. Because you have editors.
Because we have it's our call and it's totally our risk. Self-publishing has to do with the author putting up their
that's
own
what
capital.
That's what I did. I self-published three books through.
You self-published, yeah.
And I was
so
really
Levelers.
But you provided me with some editing expertise, printing expertise,
and
et cetera.
Yeah, so we'll get to that. Levelers, you know, we put up the at-risk money, all this, what we call the startup cost on a book.
Okay.
We put all that up. We've only a couple times had sort of creative capital input from authors to make a bigger printing initially, because we'll get to the Levelers model, which is sort of unique. You know, most publishers don't take on books as publishers unless they're going to do a run of really 2,000 is the minimum run in the the small publishing world. You know, like one of the great local presses is Small Beer Press. You know, and they take on 6 titles a year. If they take a title on, they do a big press run, offset press run. They sprinkle 100 review copies out across the country, right?
Now,
so that's not us.
Are you print on demand?
Virtually, in a way. Our initial press runs or print runs are really between 150 and 200 books. Mm-hmm. To have,
and when you do a second printing, is it in the same?
It could be 100, then down to 75, and then we finally print in batches of 24.
Okay.
Because we print these new. What has changed everything? We'll get to this, but it's
technology.
The touch of,
yeah.
Is that these copy machines now print on 1319 sheets, which for one service click.
And that's
and that allows you to print
four
6x9 books. In one pass through the copy machine.
And I've got to say, the quality...
The copy machines are at 2,400 DPI.
Yeah, the quality is, you know, it's... I would almost, you know, compare it to letterpress, it doesn't have, the impression, but it has the definition that's incredible.
Well, it's higher, frankly, it's as high as your high-end offset.
Yeah. They're beautiful books. I mean, they look like, you know, I remember... Black Sparrow and some of the other presses that I hung around.
Yeah, Black Sparrow really inspired me. The idea that they did, which was they printed letterpress covers for the most part on fancy paper with a flyleaf, and then did offset guts.
Okay,
right. That was kind of the Black Sparrow model, and one of our great local printers right now, Swamp Press, in Northfield, Ed Rare.
Mm-hmm.
We work with him all the time and print, and I'm printing, I mean, maybe I'll run a job for you today. I can show you how it's
That'd
printed.
That'd be great. I'd love to find out.
I'm just setting up another book for him, and he'll do die cutting and letterpress printing of the cover and hand bind the books, but we'll print the guts because this printing, and this is, in a sense, there were other reasons why I left Commonwealth. But one would be that this seemed like where things were headed. By 97, when I left there, digital printing, you know, was gonna erode a short run offset.
Yeah.
And it has.
Yeah. I always wish that I'd gotten more involved in it. I had done a reprint of a book, History of Chess, and I had it done by Book Press up in Brattleboro. And they had to do a 2,000 print run. That was like the minimum that they could do. But I was really interested in bringing back older books, and that movement really took off. I wasn't on it, the ride, but it would have been great. Nowadays, pretty much any book that's in the public domain is available in a printed copy. It's been digitized, it's somewhere in the cloud, somebody's got it, and you can, you know, without breaking copyright, create a copy of pretty much any book that's ever existed.
And amazing, huh?
It is. It's totally amazing. When you say that to people, they say, well, that's not true. Well, you can contact a library that might have the unique copy. They will do a high-definition scan of it, and provide it to you for very little money if you go through your own library. So in reality, you can get a copy of pretty much any book mm-hmm. that's out of copyright. Mm-hmm. Or in copyright if you want to pay the little bit extra.
Yeah.
But yeah, let's take a look at some printing that you do here. I'd love to see it.
One of the things that happened to spark this here was we name all of our printing machines, okay. Right?
Betsy or something.
And when Ricoh, Ricoh's a player, came out with what we the 1075, Ricoh Suave, we would call it.
Okay.
That came out at 1200 DPI. And when you looked at the difference between what a halftone, and halftones are the way you make a continuous tone photograph print with dots, so that it looks it makes it printable.
So that's what
right?
DPI is.
DPI, dots per inch.
Dots per inch.
So all the copying, people remember, laser printers started this whole thing. Remember, I had way back when at Commonwealth, when the first image writer came out from Apple, 300 DPI, that was it. In fact, 300 DPI still is kind of a standard. Then it went to 600 DPI. Mm-hmm. Well, this came out as a 1200 DPI copier, and I realized I could now print, because I love making halftones. That was one of my things I liked the most. This one now has been printed on our new 2400 DPI books, right?
This is one of printers. Your histories of publishing and printing.
And this, back in 2004, for the 350th of Northampton, I worked with folks. Barbara Blumenthal, a great binder, and works at the Mortimer Rare Book Room. There'd be another place to go.
Absolutely.
To go up and visit Barbara.
It's on the list.
She laid this out in a lovely typeface, Aldus. Which I've since grown to admire, and which we've since bought. And so we did six books in that series, and I just couldn't believe the quality. It was just like, wow. Some of this makes me feel like I've died and gone to heaven, printer's heaven, because one of the things that was so dodgy for me about offset printing was giving the customer a proof that they would sign off on that wasn't quite the real deal unless they paid for a press proof. Mm-hmm. Do you know what I mean?
Okay.
In other words, we would give them what were called blue lines. We would give them blue lines. Yep. And that would make sure that everything was in position, right? Or you might have, what did they call them? I forget, key lines, if it was color or something. But there was always this doubt when the customer came to pick it. Did we pull it off? Because the proofs never matched. Now, when you show a customer, it's on the machine. I write down, if I've had to adjust the color, I write down the adjustments I made after calibrating the machine. Mm-hmm. And I have a sample that is what they signed off on, and now I can replicate it.
So you're at 2400 DPI.
Yeah.
Is that like kind of the limit? I mean, you don't need to go. The eye can't appreciate any higher than that.
Well, I don't know. I don't know what their Xerox has up their sleeve. How these people figure out what's going to be the competitive edge for the new machines.
It sounds like you've always wanted the latest toy.
We've certainly been the beneficiaries of Xerox and others coming, keeping at this.
Yeah. And it sounds like you've always wanted the latest printing press, the latest technology. You've wanted to stay on top of it.
Well, and as much as we can afford it.
Yeah.
And that's the other beauty of it. We just got a new black and white machine last week that instead it can handle the 1319 sheet at really high resolution faster. And the whole name of our business is Service Clicks at a negotiated very, very good service click. So that's what the vendor, these machines, in a sense, this machine, which cost us, $26,000.
Wow.
Right? When you think of all the copies that machine's likely to make in its lifetime, mm-hmm. it only adds for a color copy a penny to the cost of the machine. So the machine is almost secondary to the service click in terms of how we figure things out.
Amazing. What is the name of this press?
This one is named Dobby.
How did it get the name?
Faith Seven, one of our digital gurus here at Collective Copies, names. She is the namer of our machines.
Okay.
And this one is named Dobby.
It's nice to have a
Lord of the Rings. I mean, we have Calvin and Hobbes, and we have Dobby here.
This is a machine?
Xerox 560. And it means it prints at 60 copies a minute in color, which is, that's really fast.
What year did this come out?
This came out 2 years ago, 3 years ago, maybe 3 years ago. They keep leapfrogging, but they keep supporting them. Again, to Xerox credit, because our old 242s are Calvin and Hobbes, they have certain characteristics of the way the toner is, goes onto the paper. It has, in a sense, a lot of pop. So they're really good for images that really want to pop, but they add a glossy sheen to the paper, so all of the machines we print on have their own characteristics.
Now, is the technology still the same? I mean, Xerox pioneered electrostatic
Yes, I would say so.
It's still the same.
You could talk to Stephen Roy, our founding, lone remaining founding member. He is a Xerographer. I am not.
Okay.
It's all magic to me.
Okay.
I was an art major.
Okay.
He was a physics major and went to stick.
I'll have to get some of those details.
Yeah.
So you're letting the machine warm up.
We have these panels. This is all hooked up to our computer. We have something called the Fiery command workstation and the Fiery print driver. So I'm going to call up the last job I printed and print another batch and take a peek at it. Okay, where did it go? I'll print one off and show it to you. So I log in, go to my printed queue, go to my last job I printed, and then I'm going to print me another copy. And it sends it right over and sends another copy from the machine itself or from the computer. I can tell it how many to print. I need, from the computer, I can up the density. I can change a whole lot of characteristics of the job. From the machine, I can just run the job again. So back there, I can change a lot of things from the computer. It's very, very smart. It's a really important part of what makes these machines so productive. For me, I keep thinking about how much printing is done in the country. And there's certain aspects of what we get to enjoy as printers that I think gives an indication of why we survived 2008 as well as we did. The productivity gains that we experience with these kind of machines and how much faster they get, how much better quality, and how you can manipulate files. To have watched Acrobat PDF files go from what they started out being to where they are now, it's been amazing. We have these programs that we add on that can tell me, I can tell it how many pages to put on, they're called imposition programs, where you put everything in a book. It's all done like that, and just amazing.
So now it's printing. You can do your book printing on this. Tell me a little bit about the paper that you choose.
Well, one of the things I believe that distinguishes Collective Copies and Levelers Press really is that we have a selection of papers. We cut them down offset. They're really offset papers from mill sheets. So we'll buy a carton of 25 by 38 inch paper, cut it in quarters, and it'll become our book page. So this is what I just printed. It's a book that we're printing with Ed Rare. You can see it's printed both color and black and white.
And it just did this just now.
Just
as
did
we
this.
Were sitting.
Just did
oh
this
my
right now.
Goodness, that is amazing.
Yeah, and here's this.
Beautiful.
And as I was mentioning, we print. There's a poetry collective up in Greenfield, and Ed is one of the leading lights of that group. And so this is in the Slate Roof series, and we sell them now here at the Off the Common Bookshop. So people we print for. Can have an outlet for them down here in the lower valley where people can find their books. So this is
okay. What's the next step after this? You're going to cut.
So I'm going to cut in this particular book because it's a stitched book, and we can go out and look at more slate roof slate roof additions.
Show me what you would do with this next. In
okay.
Your, in
well,
your
let's walk over. To, let's walk process. Over to the cutter. I'll put my glasses.
Here we go.
All right. So this book is printed what we call two up. It's easy to see from this signature. This is a, you know, this is printed two sheets at a time. And my first step, but I also have to be careful because this sheet bleed, the final product has to bleed. So I have to be careful of my margins here. Ed always pushes us to the limit. So you see how little margin I have out here to the edge. So I've had to print this in as close to the center as I can. So there's actually two cuts in getting this one ready. And the first will be straight in half. This is one of my favorite old machines. We got this for $1,500 when we started our Florence shop back in 2000, and it's served us well ever since. So I'm going to cut this right in half at 9.5.
I like how that comes down at an angle.
And then actually I'm going to cut to get this one ready for folding and binding, I'm going to cut the top off of this one and the bottom off of this one. So I'm coming out from the center on these two books. And this is to get it so that we have a, you know, these sets will all match up when Ed goes to bind them.
Now, this is a part of the printing process that has to be done by hand, just to get the exact feel that you want.
You mean this cutting part? Well, you have folding machines. We could possibly set this job up if we had a right angle folder. We do not have a right angle folder. We could have set it up to be able to be folded as one piece, but we couldn't. We don't have that. We're a copy shop, after all. Some copy shops, Carol at Paradise Copies, who was an old member of this collective back in the day. All right, so there are my two sets. And now the next step, and we're going to do this for Ed. Ed wants the spine to be very crisp. There's two ways to make a booklet. One is to just fold the whole thing in half, right? Which is what our booklet maker does. So that's one way to make a book, right? Fold it all in half. But if you fold them all in half, you end up with a kind of curved, you know, you can't quite have a crisp spine. So Ed likes his books to be folded each sheet in half singly, right? With a nice crisp fold.
Instead of the bulging fold.
And then collate it. So that's what I'll do. We go out on the folding machine, set it up, and get these ready for Ed to bind.
All right, let's go.
So we're now at the folding machine. I showed you I folded one in half, but this is bringing it over. It's pretty unbelievable to us. Here we are, a big, over $1 million in sales type company. And our folding machine for this company, you know?
It looks
This is
pretty.
It.
Pretty simple.
This is it, and okay. It's amazing. And our guy, Stephen Roy, our small equipment repair person, keeps it in good trim. And so I'm going to fold this sheet in half. I just put these stops. These are stops that tell the sheet how it goes up in, and I'm going to tell it right where to fold.
I'm going to come around and get right in on this.
All right. So I'm just moving these manually to where it's going to fold. I keep it from going into the second gate, and then it'll spit it out. There is our fold,
that
which
was
is
really
pretty
fast.
Close, pretty close, right? All right,
here we go.
So here we go.
All right.
So I get it set up, and then I feed them up here and let them run, and it runs like that. And then we collate them, and we ship them off to Ed, or he comes down and picks them up because he's just in Northfield.
No, so these machines are fast and efficient. Is there any danger in running these machines? I mean, it looks like if you've got your finger cut in that, it'll be all over.
Well, I mean, these are, we are an OSHA-approved shop. So I guess if you wanted to try hard, mm-hmm. you could like stick your finger, but it's actually hard to get up. In, okay. You know what I mean?
It's designed.
You'd have to go up in yeah. and underneath there.
It's a good design. Okay.
It's a good design for that, and all of our machines are.
So Steve, we've seen the production, we've heard the history, we've seen the production, now we're here at the final product, we're here in your bookstore.
Yeah.
What is the bookstore's name?
So this is the Off the Common Bookshop.
Okay.
And here we are on the Amherst Common, one of the great literary sites in the country, where just down the street Emily Dickinson lived and no doubt walked across our common here. There goes Margaret. And see you later. So to kind of round out what we had imagined, I mean, this has been an organic process of just starting out, wanting to publish people, having Bob Romer suggest we think of a name for our publishing company, and we thought up in honor of the Levellers movement in England who fought to preserve the commons from the rich folks in England. It's grown until it made sense to sell our books here, because we have cash registers set up, we're registered to pay sales tax. Why not create something where we can actually help get our authors out? We've published 60 authors, only two of which are out of the valley. We've published one Boston author and one author from Connecticut. But other than that, everybody else lives in the valley here. So. We thought, let's make a bookshop, and I think we'll be expanding again this year. This is where you can come to get our books. And then we sell them online. We have a web store as well. We also sell our books on Amazon. I mean, I hate to say that, but it's true. Amazon is a good outlet for a publisher like us who does not have a national distributor. That's the other thing that's different for us. Because of our short run, way of printing, the unit cost on the printing is higher than those folks that print 2,000 at once. So it's hard for us. It's hard for us to give a 45% or 55% discount to a distributor. We do supply local bookstores. We're great friends with Amherst Books, Odyssey, and Broadside, especially in Northampton. And that's where you can find a lot of our books here. But we really invite people to come browse here, because this is where it's happening.
Do you have a lot of libraries buying your books? Public libraries?
Forbes Library buys every Levellers title, which is wonderful. I mean, I'm so happy to be a place. And Jones has bought a lot of our titles, too. And both libraries have supported us in providing a reading for books that are appropriate to their libraries. We do readings sometimes, but we're going to try and do more readings here and invite the public to come here and build this different kind of bookstore, because we're not really in competition with other bookstores. These are only our titles that we sell right now, though we may have other titles. I would like to be able to offer to sell other books our authors have printed here, that are out of print, perhaps.
Now, you're also issuing some of these books as ebooks. Are you doing those as Kindles or what?
Kindles, EPUB, Nook. We go out into really all the ebook platforms. Randy Zuko is our ebook czar now, and has learned as much as anybody locally, I think, about how best to approach ebooks and get them out into the world.
Is that all part of the process? Right? So you publish someone's book in print, and yep. then you automatically do an ebook as well?
It's not quite automatic yet. Mm-hmm. Some of our authors don't want their books out as ebooks.
Why
so that's
that
their option. The other part of Levellers too, it's really an author-driven press. Actually, again, to what we were talking about, we're printers. Printers' goal is to please give you a product you're happy with.
Why
and that remains to
choose?
Be our that remains to be our goal with Levellers.
So, why would somebody choose not to have an ebook version of their book?
Because they want their book to be held in somebody's hand.
Okay.
Simple as that.
An aesthetic choice.
An aesthetic choice. Mm-hmm. And ebooks, though, they have many advantages. In other words, you can have hot links embedded in ebooks that that take you somewhere else that the book is talking about. I mean, that's
and you guys are
that's
involved
very
in
exciting.
Creating
we're,
those links.
Sure,
as well.
We'll work with authors to do that.
What do you think the future of something like that is? Or do you see the hybrid book as something that has a future with
you mean
videos and everything else going on inside of it?
Yeah. I can't even imagine how e-books will evolve for where they'll be able to take people, and it'll create a whole new art form. What it means to be a writer will be different. One of the things that I realize in publishing now, to get published, oftentimes publishers really want you to be as socially connected, social networked as possible, to have many platforms for selling your book yourself as an author, and that becomes somewhat of a condition of them taking you on, is that you're motivated like that?
It's good that they're on top of that, because the rise of a competitor to Amazon is going to be somebody like Facebook or Twitter.
Well, or
one
Google.
Of these social, more the social networks where you're talking to somebody about a book and you can have a pop-up to sell it right at that point.
Yeah.
That's going to be the only rival. I mean, Amazon looked like it was going to be untrammeled for forever. But the social networks are going to be the competitors for Amazon. So yeah, these writers that are interested in that, they're right.
Right. And we always, we always want to encourage people to buy directly from our web store, because that does best for our authors and best for us.
Why don't you show us some of your titles, some of your favorites,
right.
Some of the...
This was a great pleasure to work on. Paradise Found. These are all Northampton poets with many Northampton artists inside.
That's great. Yeah.
Right? Some of our favorite picture, there's Suntan Man. And here's a Scott Pryor,
Yeah. What's the title of that again?
That particular one?
This is called Paradise Found.
This is Paradise
Walking
Found.
And Biking Tour. Okay.
And in the back, which is another thing that's nice to be able to do, in the back we have a fold-out map.
Sweet.
So that you can go to the sites where these poems were inspired by, and here's one for in the backside's downtown Northampton.
Very cool.
So that was a great one to work
well,
on
got
with,
books
with the
all
folks.
Over.
And this is one we're especially proud of, which we're actually going to do a larger run of, because we got support within the worker co-op movement. This is Building Cooperative Power. We're a member of the Valley Alliance of Worker Cooperatives.
When did this come out?
This came out last year. And so we're moving it ahead. We want it to be a handbook for people who are interested in forming worker cooperatives. It tells the story of our own, like PV Squared, Pioneer Valley Photovoltaics, the Pedal People. Everybody's story is in here that's a member
and
of Bach and others.
Pelamod.
What?
Who wrote that?
Janelle Cornwell, Adam Trott, and Michael Johnson worked on it. And it's been a long time in the making.
Let's walk around and see some of these other books, because
sure.
You have them everywhere here.
Yeah. So we were talking about Building Co-op Power, which is one of our new titles we're very proud of. But this is what it was really inspired by. And this book was really one of the inspirations for me way back in the day. This is called No Bosses Here, A Manual on Working Collectively. It was brought out by Vocations for Social Change out in Boston. And it was a similar thing. It gave profiles of worker co-ops out in Boston. And this was back, when was this printed? 1974, I believe. At any rate, it was my handbook back when I started Aldebaran Press back in 77, and when Bob and I worked on Commonwealth Printing. And so I contacted all the artists and all the people who had written it, and most of them, some of them are gone now. Vocations for Social Change no longer exists, but we got permissions, and so this book, as an archive, is now available, which is one of the few times we've actually made an archival, a facsimile copy of an older book.
Now, you say you've published 60 different authors. It looks like there's a lot more than 60 books here.
Because one of the things that's happening is, and this book is going to launch on May 2nd here at the Off the Common Bookshop. Here's our Off the Common book logo, and we're helping him self-publish. In other words, we are not the publisher.
So Levelers has 60.
Levelers is the distributor, in a sense, for this book. And we have another 60 authors that are off the that we consider to be part of our off the common family, and we're trying to grow that part of our business too. For whatever reason, they either don't want us to publish it, or they just want to self-publish, you know, or it wasn't a fit, a good fit for us. But we're still printers here, so we really want to print.
What would it cost? Okay, let's say I'm a self-publisher. I've written a book and I want to get it published. What's it going to cost me?
What's it going to cost you? All right. Well, for layout and design, for us to do the layout and design, you know, I usually estimate between $2 and $4 a page of your book, so it can be quite expensive from the get-go. So this is 150 pages, so you can imagine it being from $300 to $600
or more. Still a lot cheaper than the big self-publishing companies that can run into the thousands.
And this can, depending on what's needed editorially mostly, and for design and for photographs and all that, it can run up above that depending. Editorial material, you know, and I don't think they do necessarily a great job of editorial. They don't expect to do much editorially. But so that's the upfront cost. So say this is a 1450 book.
Yeah.
That's what they wanted to price it for.
You have people here that can help a self-published author get edited, get
all yeah, that help. There's a network of Valley editors and proofreaders, and we work with Jean Zimmer a fair amount. She's done a number of our books and others for getting editorial services. So, but it's expensive. Imagine reading a book on a clock, but marking it up and reading it so carefully that you're responsible for any punctuation problems or misspelled words. It's a lot of pressure on an editor. So it is one of the challenges to maintain editorial standards here in this rapid, you know, it's easy to bring a book out quick, in a sense. You know.
Well, even large publishers are very poorly edited. I've seen.
Yeah, I find typos in books as I'm doing, but it's a problem, and it's one we want to address and get better at. You know.
Well, I think, Steve, we've seen the whole process from the history of what you've been doing to the actual printing, and now to the bookshop and into the marketplace. You're working with ebooks. You're working with the social networks. You're really doing it all, and I think, you know, Mass Center for the Book is really going to appreciate seeing this whole holistic approach to publishing.